to you not like I normally come. I love to tell a story. I believe that the greatest storyteller that ever lived is Jesus Christ mm-hmm. himself. And he used stories to always bring us to him, to truth, and to healing. And so I've learned the power of story. And so he wants to invite you into your story. He wants to lead you and guide you into your story. He doesn't want to write your story for you. He won't. He's a gentleman. I move around a lot, so. Seriously, he says, I love you as you are. I choose the day that you are born, and I choose the day that you die. But everything in between that is your life, and you choose how to spend it. And you choose how to write it, and you choose what will happen to you. That's your story, and he wants to invite you into your story today. You cannot change yesterday. No. We stay stuck. We want to sometimes go back and change things or go back the way it was. And he said, no, I want you today to stay in the present moment and be with me today and write your story today that will change what tomorrow brings. It's really important that we learn that as women, because I think we stay stuck in what was or what could be instead of what is. And the Lord is here with us today. And he wants us to be right here. So I have lived a life of beautiful sunrises and sunsets. I love the sunrise and I love the sunset. To me, they are holy moments in the day. And everything between the sunrise and the sunset is my day. This is a sunrise in Spain. I spent many years living in Spain, and we face east, so we don't see sunsets, we see sunrises. And I wanted to show you a few sunrises. This last year, I have had so much loss that I have begun to look up more than I ever did. When the sun rises, it speaks to me a new day for me to start another page in my life. And then there is the sunsets in California. I'm born here, but most of my life I have spent over in Europe. My husband and I and our four daughters spent over 30 years doing international mission work in four different countries. This is one of my favorite sunsets, right before the sun's going down. The sky speaks to me, and I'll explain more why as I tell you a bit more of my story. I love this one, where God's hands are all. And there's a reason that we have crosses in our life. There's reasons why we have suffering. There's reasons why we have joy. There's reasons why we have pain and sorrow. There's reasons why we're full and sometimes empty. So today, I invite you into my story. I got married as a teenager. I say that I was like a teeny bride. And I love that. I like always wanted to be a mom and be married. That was like my life dream. I didn't realize God would take me to other countries and that I would learn other languages and that I would learn to serve other people, including my family. But I have families all over the world, which is a joy. But today I wanted to share with you about the importance of writing the story of honesty and authenticity through pain and sorrow and goodness and loss and being honest with who you truly are. because you're the only one that can be honest with yourself. Other people can ask you to be, but you have the choice to write your story in honesty to how you live your life today. And it's a safe place to be honest. Sometimes we think it isn't, but God wants us to be honest. Well, today I have brought you some visuals that are important to me. And here I have a vessel. You see this? This is a ceramic pot, a vessel, empty, right? I get to choose what I put inside this vessel. That's you. You're his vessel, created for his good pleasure. Sometimes things happen, and this vessel no longer is empty. Sometimes it's full. Sometimes it gets shattered. And it's scary. And we ask God why. And we say it's not fair. I thought you made me beautiful. I thought you made me your daughter. I thought you asked things of me so that I could glorify you. And he says, yes, but I am closer to you when you have a broken heart than when you don't. These pieces are shattered. My heart has been shattered, especially this last year. Has your heart been shattered ever? I think we all have, at least one time in our life, if not more, had a broken heart. And God says, I'm near to you. He didn't guarantee this life would be without pain. He actually promised that we would have pain, suffering, loss, sorrow, death, and the choice to live again, and the choice to forgive. And the choice to pick up every morning and say, I'm going to get dressed no matter what. I'm going to trust you no matter what. No matter where you are in my life, I'm going to choose every day. Because you are close to me. Your promises never fail. Never fail. His promises never, ever, ever, ever fail. If we believe that, then we will hold on to what is true, not what we think. He says to me this last year, I will keep you, Arianna, in perfect peace when you are thinking about me. I promise you, I will keep you in perfect peace. Did I feel perfect peace this whole last year?
No.
But God, you promised me that. Yes, I'm your peace, not your thoughts. I'm your peace, not the circumstance. I'm your peace, not the people who've died in your life. I didn't take those people away from you. I invited them into eternity. Ooh, change it around. So our family spent over 30 years living in Greece, Germany, and Spain, doing international work. We have helped thousands of people through different modalities, whether it was church planting or come alongside approach, or children's ministry, or arts ministry, or college ministry. We have helped a lot of people come to know Christ, clothed in the culture that we lived in. And we've seen a lot and experienced a lot, but there was this sense of, well, we're yours, God. We're never gonna experience tragedy. That is a fallacy in our American culture. We are gonna experience tragedy. It's part of the journey of life. It's not that it happens or it doesn't happen. It's what do we do with it when it does happen? Where are we as women of faith? Broken and shattered, yes. Does he promise to put me back together? Yes, I want it done yesterday. He said, no. Your life is in my hands every day I get up. And I say, yes, Lord. My life is in your hands, but I don't like it very much right now. But I do trust you, and I won't stop trusting you. I won't stop trusting you. That is a key I want you ladies to remember in writing your story. You choose every day who you trust, how you trust. Remember, he has your birth and your death in his hands. And in the life that you live, you choose if you will trust him. So I have four beautiful daughters, and one decided to go to heaven this year. But we were not ready for that. She was vibrant. I've made a little altar of love I'm going to share with you. She was vibrant, loved Jesus with her whole heart. Everywhere she went, there were people that would follow her aroma of Christ. Have you ever heard that you're the aroma of Christ? She was by many means. I have four beautiful daughters. Her little sister, Havala, her big sister, Harmony, her oldest sister, Nicola. They are the most beautiful women on this earth. I adore all four of them. But this one, we did a lot of life together. And when she was diagnosed with ovarian cancer just a year ago, we said, what? Shira? Really? Well, what's ovarian cancer? What do you mean she has cancer? And we did all our studies, and we found out everything possible for her to be able to heal. We lost her 5 months later. Only 5 months. And it was tragic how she was treated. But the Lord was with me. And at night, I was her caregiver. And at night, between 3 and 6 were the hardest hours. And she'd say to me, Mom, where is Jesus? I said, he's with us. He's with us. He's in the boat with us. He's never going to leave us. He promises he will never leave us. Well, why isn't he healing me? He will. He also promises that, either here on earth or in heaven. He promises that he will heal you. So through the nights, we would pray Psalm 23 in the Passion Version. And I'd like you to close your eyes with me right now. And just imagine yourself, your greatest pain or fear or shattered moment. And I want you to hear the voice of God speaking to you. And he says, the Lord is my best friend. He's my shepherd. I always have more than enough. He offers a resting place for me in his luxurious love. He takes me to an oasis. The quiet brooks of bliss. That's where he restores and revives my life. He opens before me pathways to God's pleasure, and he leads me along the footsteps of righteousness so that I can bring honor to his name. Lord, even your path takes me through the valley of the deepest darkness. Fear will never conquer me, for you already there, conquering it. You remain close to me, and you lead me in all the ways I go. Your authority is my strength and my peace. The comfort of your love takes away all of my fear. I'll never be lonely, for you are near. You become my delicate feast. Even when my enemies dare to fight, you anoint me with fragrance of your Holy Spirit. You give me all I can drink of you until my heart overflows. So why would I fear the future? For I'm being pursued by your goodness. feeling love. Then afterward, when my life is through, I'll return to your glorious presence forever with you. Is over, I will return to your glorious presence, and you will put me back together. I watched my daughter suffer. I watched her sisters suffer. I watched their father suffer, her husband, friends. Why, Shira? You know what? Why not, Shira? Do I trust God with her life? Absolutely. Do I think I can make a better decision? Sometimes. But He loves her so much. His divine mercy said, I'm taking her home. Well, I don't like that. And I disagree with God. And I have been arguing with Him, trying to understand why. He's not going to tell me why. He asks me to trust Him and learn how to live not without her, learn how to live with her today. I had her for 33 years, 33 years. She died 4 days after her 33rd birthday. But I had her for 33 years, and my life is forever changed, so I'm going to turn it around. And I'm going to say, it's not life without her. It's learning life with her as she dwells in heaven. We live constantly in the presence of God and desiring the Holy Spirit to guide us. And we feel Him and we hear Him. Why can't I also learn how to live with my daughter? Is she an angel? I don't know, but I know she's with Jesus. And I know she's still with me in this shape in my heart that I said is so empty. And God says, no, it's full of Arianna. It's full of Shira. It's full of me. Turn our story around that we're writing, the things we tell ourselves. What's the truth? Does everything God do, is everything He thinks, all the decisions He makes, are they good? Yes. Argue with that. I don't understand. But my story is being written in a new way. And your story can be written in a new way if you change it around. What is God saying here? I don't know. But I do know He's good. And I do know He's always with me. And I do know He doesn't do anything without purpose. Well, 10 hours before my daughter passed, my daddy passed. 10 hours before my daughter passed, my daddy passed, who was my anchor. And I didn't know it for the day after that he had passed. So I lost two beautiful people in my life who are very important to me. My daddy is my hero. 3 weeks later, a dear woman I mentored in Germany passed. 2 weeks after that, a dear friend here in California passed. 3 months later, my niece passed. And my dear pastor friend, who pastored me for 30 years, passed. In the last 7 months, I've had 7 people go to heaven who I love. Do I understand why? No. Do I trust God? Yes. Is it fair? No. Did God ever promise life was fair? No. But what I'm going to hold on to is the promises that are true. And I'm going to write that in my story. And I'm going to learn how to make altars of love. So I want to share this with you over here. Does anybody know what this is?
Vase.
A vase.
Alabaster? Alabaster?
Alabaster, yes. This is what's called a tear jar. In Jewish tradition, when women would lose loved ones, they were given a tear jar to carry with them. And in the days, they would actually fill the tear jar with their tears. And at night, they would set this out in front of their door. And we're talking about the desert, so in the morning it was dried up. But they would fill their tear jars with tears every day until the appointed time that their mourning was over. And usually the mourning time for Jews was 40 days. I'm going to read you in the scriptures where it says this, because it's part of the story of loss, learning how we mourn and are we okay with tears. Sometimes we're not, but God gave us tears to heal and tears to process. Let me read you what the scripture says here, the tear jar description. It's actually in Psalm 56, verse 8. It says, "You've kept track of all my wanderings and all my weepings. You've stored my many tears in your bottle, and not one will be lost, for they all recorded in your book of remembrance." Ladies, he is recording all your tears in his bottle. He sees them, he feels them, he's with you. He gave you tears of joy, tears of sadness, tears of suffering, tears of shatteredness, tears of question. He holds all those tears in his jar of remembrance. Isn't that beautiful? So part of my process of learning how to let go and accept that my daughter has gone to heaven before me, which when I see her, I'm just like, that was not fair. I wasn't ready for you to go. I wanted to go first. I've lived longer on this earth.
Selfish.
Yeah.
Me first.
But in the understanding of my process, God says, you will suffer a little bit, but then joy will come. I don't really know that joy yet, but I know a lot of acceptance, and I know the presence of God. I was invited to visit a friend of mine, and I didn't want to travel. This was 3 months after Shira passed. And I just didn't want to go. I didn't want to go anywhere without her. And my friend mentored her. And so she said, please just come. Let's have some time and talk about Shira's passing. Is it okay? So I flew to see her, and that was like drama for me to get on that plane. And you guys don't realize I'm an international traveler. I've traveled most of my life. But I didn't feel that when I was visiting my friend in Atlanta, Georgia. When I got there, she had an evening that she had to go out, and so I was alone, and I said, well, I'd like to walk downtown and just walk downtown. That's what Shira used to like to do. She loved people and loved walking, so she dropped me off downtown, and I found a little tiny Spanish restaurant, and that's where we lived. That was the last place that we lived abroad, and one of Shira's happy places. And I walked in the Spanish restaurant, but it was not authentic, and I was like, but I was in Atlanta, Georgia, right? Because I'd never been before. And so I said, well, what are you guys known for? Southern food. Okay, great. Well, can you tell me the best Southern food restaurant that I can walk to? Because I'm downtown, visiting my friend. So they told me, yes, it's called the Southern Gentlemen's Club. Went, oh, that's a weird name. Sure, well, tell me where it is, okay? So I'm walking there, and all of a sudden, my mind's going, Gentlemen's Club. That sounds a little shady. But I was going to go because they told me, yeah, I'm walking there, and I'm like, okay. And I want you to see that I brought a suitcase with me. We all carry stuff with us, whether you realize it or not. You carry stuff with you wherever you go. So I'm walking, and I'm carrying this thought of, oh my gosh, it's a weird name. And I get up there, dark, and all you see is this red light. Southern gentlemen's kind of like, ooh. They told me it was the best Southern food. And I just go, I just turn around, I'm just talking to Shira, right? I do that now, I'm talking to Shira. I used to talk to God all the time, well now I share him with her, or her with him. So you guys, I'm standing out and I'm thinking, this was a setup. This, and I'm alone downtown Atlanta. And I'm like, oh my gosh, what do I do? This is feeling really weird, the heart's going dur, 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 dur. And out comes a family. So I thought, okay, and I can go in there, but you know, I was thinking, Southern gentleman's club. So I walk in, and I look around, you guys. There's not one table empty. It's completely full, but they're all Afro-American. I'm the only whitey that's walking in that restaurant. I'm like, oh boy, sheer joy, what am I doing? And I look around, there's not a seat open. And I think, don't you dare turn around and walk out. This is the Southern Gentleman's Club. I was told to go here. Best food, find a place. Well, there's a little bar. Now, you guys don't know me. I got married as a teenager. I don't know what bars look like. Never been into bars. But there was like a bar that you could sit at. But it looked like they were all drinking. And I just wanted to have something to eat. But the only place that was available was at the bar. So I feel this little push. Go sit at the bar. Oh. I've never sat at a bar by myself in a Southern Gentleman's Club. I'm like, okay, I'm just writing my story. Just writing my story. I can do this. I can do things afraid. Because she's with me. I mean, he's with me. I mean, if you guys have ever not lost a child, you'll know what I'm doing. I'm just having fun with it. Because she is always with me. So I sit down at the bar. I'm like, okay, I've never done this before. What do you do? Hi, how you doing? You know, you got this nice little accent. And I'm like, what kind of food do you have? And if you know me, I'm like a little Mother Earth, so I like things natural, and I'm a vegetarian, and I don't eat meat, and they got everything fried there. So I'm like, okay, do you have anything like cheese? Salad? He's like, yeah, sure, ma'am, I do. And so I ordered cheese sticks, or I think that's what it was. So anyway, and then, he's going to get that and get me a drink, and I'm sitting there like this, you guys. I'm sitting at the bar feeling really uncomfortable. So I just do this. At a bar. In Atlanta, Georgia. Southern Gentleman's Club. And all of a sudden, hey girl. Hey girl, I see you. I'm like, hey girl, I see you. You is praying. And where two or three are gathered, there I am also. Sure enough, there's a woman sitting right next to me. And she goes, you is praying, aren't you? I said, yeah, I am. She goes, I'm a believer. What she's praying about? I was like, oh my gosh, this is what happens at bars? I mean, it's a restaurant bar. And I said, well, I was just talking to my daughter who decided to go to heaven. She goes, oh my gosh, Mama, I'm gonna pray for you. She gets her husband right next to her. They come over, they lay hands on him. He's like a big, tall guy. And these are all Afro-American people, beautiful. And I'm like, yeah, sure, you can pray for me. And they're like, in the name of Jesus, you go be healed, Mama, because she's right where she's supposed to be. She's in heaven, and she is glorifying the Lord, and you're gonna be healed, Mama. Oh my gosh, I'm in a Southern Gentleman's Club. I'm the only white person and he's praying like everybody can see him. It's going on and on. About 10 minutes, and I'm just like, don't open your eyes. Don't open your eyes. Just let them do what they're doing. Just let them do what they're doing. So they finish their prayer. They sit back down next to me, and up comes the manager. And first it's the waitress. Hey, Mama, I just heard the news. You lost your daughter? Well, I lost my mama 2 weeks ago. Can I have a mama hug from you? At the bar. So I gave her a mama hug, and we're praying for her. And she's a waitress. I gotta go back to my table. Then up comes the hostess. Hey, Mama, I just heard the news. You have lost your daughter. Well, can I tell you about my uncle? And she starts telling Mama. I just heard the news that you are in mourning. Well, you know what? This is the best Southern food in Atlanta, Georgia, and we want to make sure you got enough food for tomorrow so you can order anything on the menu. It's all in the house for me. Oh my gosh, how kind is that? I'm like, sure, just tell me what kind of vegetarian meat doesn't eat my food. So I think he ordered me shrimp and grits. Is that what it's called?
Yeah.
And they gave me food to take home the next day. So then I'm sitting there, and I'm just like, this is so beautiful. This is actually healing to my heart. Healing to my heart. Because I took time to do something afraid in my story. I took time to go out of my comfort zone. I took time to also pray and not be afraid to bow my head at a bar. And then I took like a little red wine. So I ordered the red wine, and me and Sherry used to love our red wine together, and I had a glass. Well, as I was getting ready to leave, I was just so full of the presence of God with these people, and I closed up the place. They all were going out, hey Mama, and they'd say goodbye to me, and they were leaving. It was like, it's so beautiful. And at the very end, the bartender came up to me with a glass of wine, and he said, here Mama, I don't know who poured this glass, but this is for you. And Jesus wants you to know that he died for your sins. And he's going to wash you clean. And he's going to heal your broken heart. Boy, did I drink that last wine. And I was grateful that I went downtown, afraid and lonely for my daughter. And I went into this restaurant, and those people were so kind. I called them my black angels. They gave me so much comfort and hope. Wherever I go, I'm not going to be afraid to talk about my daughter that went to heaven. She's part of my story. Ladies, there's something in your story that's hard, that's broken, that's painful. Maybe you're not healed yet. Maybe you're in the process of healing. Maybe you're already healed. I don't know where you are in your story, but God does. And he doesn't want you to be afraid to let that part be written on your life, on your heart, the aroma you leave behind, the truth that pain hurt. Pain is suffering, and it hurts, but God promises to heal. It doesn't matter how long it takes. Well, I left that place, and I came home, and I learned about altars of love. And I want you guys to know that altars of love are important to us that are left behind, or us that have the joy to live on. So my altar of love is my sheer joy, my tears, my tear jar, the cross that she held like this as she was passing. Wooden heart that we had got in Jerusalem when we traveled there together. A butterfly rock that a dear friend of mine painted for me because Shira Joy died on May 11th. And every day until December 7th, I saw a butterfly. And they visited me. I know she's not a butterfly. But God uses beautiful things when we least expect it. To have touch with the Spirit, to have touch with those that pass. He does beautiful things. So butterflies are something new and important to me. And then I have three heart rocks because her and I used to walk on the beach a lot, and our passion was to find rocks shaped as hearts. And I love the number three because that's the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And she loved him. She loved her God, and she loved her family. She loved well, all the people she knew. If you knew her, she walked into a room and it was, and she loved me well. Do I miss that? Yes. Am I incredibly sad and sometimes I can't get out of bed? Yes. But do I trust God? Yes. And the only book I have left of her is her Jesus Calling. And the day that we buried her, this stick fell from the tree. So I hold it as an altar of love somewhere. She's near. write your stories. Whatever they are, they're beautiful. Whether they're hard or not, there will be times of suffering. There will be times of challenges. There will be times of joy. There will be dreams that you say, why is my dream taken from me or broken? God may not tell you why. I'd like you to close your eyes and listen to this song and let the Spirit of God speak to you. Heavenly Father, there's so much we don't understand, and yet we trust you. May all our sorrow and our loss and our grief and our pain, may we bring those to you, that you may turn our joy, that we will turn our hearts, that you will turn the things that seem impossible, they become possible with you. That as we allow you to invite us into our story, that we would write well the truth and not be afraid of the pain, not be afraid of the loss. Father in heaven, I don't understand, but I trust you. I will never stop trusting you. And I pray the power of peace that passes all understanding, that the beautiful choice of trust will be upon each woman here that heard a little bit of my story, that it may be inspiring for them to know that no one has ever the Son, and the Holy Spirit, that you may guide these women.